admin. So,
sir, would you like to check the PPT?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Can you see this one?
No, sir, not yet. Ha, yes, sir.
Now, okay, sir.
Yes, sir, we can see.
Yes, sir, yes.
Perfect.
Okay.
Can't you make it full screen?
It's okay.
Yes, full screen अभी तक नहीं हुआ है सर. एक बार full screen करेंगे.
Full screen किया मैंने.
Okay, it's not showing here.
इसे पाव, इसे Not showing, sir.
I think you have stopped sharing, perhaps.
Yeah, yes.
Rutuja?
Yes, sir.
Please put message on the HMC and underwater group.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll just put a message, sir.
Other students should join.
Can you see it now?
Yes, sir.
You can see it, but not full screen, sir.
Okay, full screen I will do.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you see it now, full screen?
No, sir.
Not yet. It is very slow, perhaps.
Possible?
Connectivity problem, perhaps.
I don't know why it is not showing.
Hello, Amrita.
Huh? Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Okay, then I have to show like this only, but not part, just not fully screen.
But you
okay.
can do that. You can go in fact full screen.
I can do it from here with screen.
Yeah, of course. You are sharing the screen.
Sir, can you try from the down bar, toolbar, where it is showing default design?
No, I am using it that the presentation mode.
Okay, you can even do it from the down bar.
Yeah, from there only I have done it.
Okay, but it's still not showing.
So you might have to put it into the PPT mode. It's currently right now not in the slideshow mode.
Yeah, I put it
whenever I'm putting in slideshow. Okay. Now?
No.
No, sir.
What you are seeing now?
We can see. We can't see. Full
yeah, not full screen, sir. Not full screen.
I don't know what else I should do. It's not showing full screen.
No, just say resume slideshow. Can you click on the resume slideshow?
From where I have to do it.
Okay. Sir, can you select the entire screen option during selection of this full screen?
Ha, do it from there, sir. Yes. It's still not coming, why?
That's why I wanted to show it, put it little earlier. Anyway, then I have to do it with the normal show rather than this.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Not a problem. We can see also, sir. It's not a problem. We can see.
Okay, this is fine. This you can see it.
Yes, yes. We can see clearly.
Yeah. Okay, from here only then I have to do it because slideshow it is not picking up.
Okay. Okay, sir. No problem. No problem. Okay, Professor Sable, sir, do we start now? Should we start,
yes,
please?
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Joshi, sir, we'll start now, sir.
Sir is here.
Yeah, yeah, I know. Sir, we'll start.
Okay, you can start. I leave it to you.
Yeah, okay, sir. Prasad, sir, are you there, sir? We are starting.
Joshi sir,
I think he's mute.
Ah,
because he will also say a few words. Let me just call him and tell him ki we are starting.
I'll ask him.
Yeah, just call him, na sir.
Yeah, I am with Joshi sir. He's joining in 1 minute.
Okay,
he's
okay.
There, but he's on some call. He's joining in.
Okay, okay, no problem, no problem. Okay, thank you, Bhav.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, sir, we'll start now.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, okay, okay. So, very good morning to all of you and welcome to our Archaeology Discussion Group lecture. Today is a very special occasion. We have organized this lecture on the occasion of World Environment Day and World Ocean Day. 5th June was World Environment Day and 8th June was World Ocean Day. We are very honored and happy to have with us Dr. Rajiv Nigam, sir. Of course, he needs no introduction, especially to Deccan College people. He has been associating with us for a very long time. He is a CSIR Emeritus Scientist and a former Chief Scientist of NIO Goa, National Institute of Oceanography. And his specialization is on paleoclimate, on sea level changes, paleomonsoon, marine archaeology, and so on. And today he will be giving a talk on sea level changes in paleoenvironment. Now, as students of archaeology, you all know that archaeology is an interdisciplinary subject. And studying and understanding paleoenvironment is a very important part of all of our research. It doesn't matter whether you're pursuing your research on prehistory or protohistory or any time period, because what we do study is cultural manifestation. And we all know that cultural manifestations are extremely dependent on environment, on our surrounding ecology. And I feel we as cultural heritage specialists and people, whoever is studying cultural heritage, we have a great responsibility of making a sustainable future, making a sustainable ecology for our planet Earth. Last weekend also we had Shukriya Chakraborty sir's lecture, and if you remember, he had mentioned that since the Industrial Revolution, because of the anthropogenic factors, we have added almost 0.85 to 1 degree centigrade in the temperature rise, which is really scary, because if that has happened in the last 250, 300 years, and if we continue on the same line, what damage we are going to do to us, to our life, to our future generations' life, and to Mother Earth. So it's very important that we understand the importance of studying environment, we understand what needs to be done as cultural heritage specialists in order to safeguard the environment and our Mother Earth. So basically for this purpose, we have specially organized today's lecture, and we thank you all for joining us. We're also very happy today, Sable sir will be giving a little more detailed introduction about Rajiv Nigam sir. But before that, let me say that we are very happy and honored to have with us today our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Prasad Joshi sir. So, sir, I request you to please say a few words on this occasion. Thank you so much.
Namaskar. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, very good afternoon to all of you. Professor P.D. Sable, the guest of honor today, Dr. Rajiv C. Nigam, who is coordinating the activity Dr. Amruta Sarkar and dear friends. I take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Rajiv Nigam to our college and in this program. Actually, Dr. Nigam is always with us and is a part of our curriculum and curricular activities also. And whenever we extend him our invitation, he very readily accepts. And this is again in the same attitude that he has accepted our invitation and joined this program. So once again, I welcome you, sir. Thank you for sharing your time and sharing your experience with us. This particular activity of group discussion is very important, and it is treated as one of the best practices of our department. All the three departments have this practice of group discussion, and it is going to give us opportunity to listen to eminent scholars in the field and have upgrade and get ourselves upgraded with this their experience. So I particularly appreciate initiatives taken by the coordinator in organizing this activity. We are celebrating the Environmental Day, the Earth Day, as mentioned by Dr. Amruta Sarkar, and we have to be aware of the fact that whatever we are today is because of the environment. It is our duty to protect it as it is and hand over to the next generation in the well, you know, preserved kind of condition. And right from the ancient literature, we have occurrences, we have references to the protection of this environment and the earth. Atharva Veda says, Mata Bhumihi. Prithvi is regarded, the earth is regarded as Mata, and Putroham Prithvija, and I am the son of this planet. So if this kind of relation is maintained of a son and mother, then probably it is the best way approach to the earth. So I congratulate once again the coordinators and secretary who are behind organization of this activity. So thank you all of you for participating, and welcome to Dr. Rajiv Nigam. With a few words, I would like to answer. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Joshi sir. Thank you for those enlightening words and encouraging words. We are also very happy and honored to have with us today our former Vice Chancellor, Professor Vasant Shinde sir. Thank you sir for joining us in spite of your overwhelming busy hectic schedule. You're always a part of our family, and we are always happy to have you with us. So we would request you to please maybe share a few words on this occasion.
Yeah, thank you, Amruta. I am really happy that, you know, I am speaking a few words about my friend Rajiv Nigam. Now he is, I think everybody knows that he is the best marine geologist, environmental scientist in the country, and he is the one in fact who has generated so much scientific data to shed light on some of the archaeological mysteries. For example, you know, he is the one in fact who supported, you know, that Lothal is a dockyard, and he generated so much data in that particular respect, and now everybody accepts that. Secondly, you know, he also had worked at Dwarka, and he has studied the environment at Dwarka, and shown in fact how the environment climate has impacted the cultural levels at Dwarka. So that is also very scientific work that he has done. Thirdly, he also has worked on Ram Setu and generated a lot of data on climate. And he also has a date for this particular structure. So that is also very important work. And finally, you know, I would like to mention that, you know, he also has generated some scientific data to explain the thick walls at the site of Dholavira. In fact, maybe next week sometimes, myself and Rajiv Nigam, we are going to speak on Dholavira, the Harappan metropolis par excellence. And I'm going to speak on the archaeological part, and he's going to speak on the climatic part and the scientific studies that he has done. So I'm really happy that, you know, that person of such eminence is speaking on this particular occasion. And I really look forward to, you know, hear him. And I'm sure that, you know, all the participants will be happy. They will go back with new knowledge and new scientific insight. He's the one, in fact, who has helped Technical College, the Department of Archaeology, to run the Marine Archaeology diploma here. And he is very much, you know, part of that, integral part of that particular activity that we undertook. And he also took initiatives in taking our Marine Archaeology diploma students to Goa for training. So I really appreciate, you know, his help, and, you know, we want that, you know, he remains associated with the Department of Archaeology in future also. So that will certainly help. So I thank, you know, the organizers for inviting me to speak a few words, and I look forward to listen to Dr. Raju Nigam. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your kind words. So now I invite our HOD, Dr. Sable sir, to officially introduce Rajiv Nigam sir.
Good morning, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Prasad Joshi sir, our former Vice Chancellor Professor Vasant Chinde sir, today's speaker Dr. Rajiv Nigam from NIO Goa, staff and student of Deccan College, Deemed University, and other student also, diploma student, and you all. Friends, I welcome you on this auspicious occasion of the world, and we are celebrating here the World Environmental Day, as well as the World Ocean Day. On this occasion, this lecture is specially organized. The title of the lecture, you know, Sea Level Changes and Paleo Environment. See, friend, in the last lecture, Amrita Sarkar ma'am already mentioned, yeah, how the sea level changes takes place during the isotope analysis lecture. So once the heating, excess heating takes place, the ice melting takes place, and the river start to flooded, and ultimately the water is met to the ocean and the sea level rise takes place. And what about the settlement which are present along the coastline? Because the India is having very narrow patch from south to north, which is bounded by east and west coast. And therefore, in this very wild area, which is occupied by the water and densely populated by the settlements along both sides, so what will be the effect of the sea level changes or sea level rise? So that we are going to study or understand from this today's lecture, and within a short time, after very busy schedule, our Rajiv Nigam sir, he is always helping, and our Vasant Shinde sir already mentioned ki this present diploma course, that is the first course, 1 year diploma course, that is underwater archaeology, this course is start because of the efforts of these both, that is Professor Vasant Shinde sir, as well as from NIO side, Rajiv Nigam sir. And because of his efforts only, so this course is start. And first of all, I thanks for the same. Friend, today I am indeed very happy to introduce my one of the mentor in the earth science, that is Rajiv Nigam sir, who passed his master degree from Aligarh Muslim University and PhD from the same university, and PhD and DSc from foreign university. He worked as a head of Earth Science Division at NIO Goa, and he was a chief scientist and retired as an assistant director of National Institute of Oceanography, and now working as a emeritus scientist after retirement also, he stick up with his sea level changes and paleo environment work. So his work is a tremendous. How I can means what start the introduction? It is a really means what problem for the introducer. So he published so many papers. If you put the name of Dr. Rajiv Nigam sir in a Google, you will get out so many hundreds of paper in the national and international journal. He edited so many volumes and books and souvenirs. He organized number of conference and seminars. So every staff members of the Deccan College, they know very well. So the NIO organized conference and seminar, they have participated. And during the tenure of Dr. Rajiv Nigam sir, so he joined this NIO CSIR Institute in 1978, and he retired on 13 April 2016, and his work of domain was marine geochemistry, and he worked as a scientist. So he during his tenure, not only earth sciences but the marine archaeology, that is underwater archaeology wing, they have carried out lot of work, exploration and excavation. The most important excavation during his tenure, that is near the Goa, where our student used to visit that area frequently for the training purpose. And because of his efforts only, he carried out the project of project sanction and carried out the excavation at that area. And today also, because of his efforts only and collaboration, so many scientists of NIO Goa, they are helping our student directly and indirectly throughout the year during the training at the NIO Goa, as well as for the dissertation and lecture and all kind of help. So with this, I once again thanks to today's speaker, Dr. Rajiv Nigam sir, and I hand over this session to Amrita Sarkar ma'am for the next session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sable sir. So we'll now start with the lecture. Just a few rules. When the lecture is on, you all are requested to switch off both your audio and video. If you have a query, please, you can type it in the chat box. I will be monitoring the chat box continuously. And after end of the lecture, I will be presenting each and every question to Nigam sir. At that point of time, if any one of you wants to interact directly with Nigam sir, you can always raise the hand button and we'll definitely give you a chance to speak to him. So with that, Nigam sir, the stage is all yours. You can start your lecture.
Professor Joshi, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Vasant Shindeji, the former Vice Chancellor and the best archaeologist I ever known, Professor Sable, Dr. Amrita Sarkar, the distinguished faculty, the students and friends. It's always a pleasure to be with the Deccan College, either physically at Pune or online. But at the same time, I would like to apologize to some of you who have heard this lecture before, because there's bound to be repetition. When you deliver too frequent the lectures, it is very difficult to add something new every time. So those who have heard it before, my apology in advance. But definitely questions may be new, so you can hear the lecture and put lot of questions which can put me on the right track. This lecture started with the note that the World Environment Day and the World Ocean Day. The ocean constitute the two-thirds part of the globe, and it's control the climate, particularly on the Indian subcontinent, which is in form of monsoon. And monsoon also played a very dominant role in shaping the history of mankind at least this part of the world. But today's lecture, we'll be mostly dealing with the sea level changes. Professor Shinde very aptly described the topic which I am going to speak. He knows my work, I think, bit by everything. That's why he could include all the points which I am going to talk today. So sea level is a very important phenomena, and few questions are there. Why one has to study the sea level? How it is relevant to the mankind of today? How it is important to know how it controls the climate? How sea level has fluctuated? How to get the idea about the past sea level? How to generate the past sea level records? And how this past, the understanding of the past sea level is going to explain some of the very famous archaeological mysteries, particularly the marine archaeological mysteries of our country. So with this a brief introduction, I would like to come to my slides. I will ask Amrita to unmute her mic and tell me whether she can see the slides. Amrita, can you see the slides?
Yes, sir. Slide is visible. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So, sea is, you can see that the Indians are very well known about this slide. The churning of the sea, the Samudra Manthan story. That shows that how well Indians are aware about the sea and its utility. And this story is so popular, even beyond the Indian territory. You can see here I have put it, it's a depiction at Singapore airport. There's a story of the Samudra Manthan. I will say the Samudra Manthan is still on. Okay, now the scientists are exploring the sea for various purposes because sea always play a very dominant role in our life. Friends, I would like to start with this slide. When you open the newspaper in the morning, every day you get a news item like this. The world's warm up, the global warming, the city sea level rising. This is about the Nobel. This is about the part of the work on which India was given a Nobel Prize. Okay, the, how sea level is going to change. Why all this phenomena is happening and why it is becoming the talk of the town? That is explained with this cartoon. This is one of my very favorite cartoons, which I am using almost in all my presentations. See the Mother Earth having a protective umbrella of the gases, which includes the greenhouse gases. Now, these greenhouse gases have a property that allow the energy to come from the sun, which is in form of the short wave. And then Earth radiate back this energy, which is in the long wave. A part of this energy has been absorbed by the greenhouse gases, and that's why Earth is warm. Now you can see the Earth is in tear because what happened? This umbrella has been damaged. We started trapping more outgoing energy because we added artificially too much of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Excess of any, see, greenhouse gases are important to have a life on the Earth. Because of them, the Earth is warm. But excess of anything is bad, so is the greenhouse gases, and this is likely to change the climate. Climate is nothing but the energy balance. We receive the energy from the sun, and Earth radiates back the energy, and the balance is the climate. Now, this excess greenhouse gases and climate change have a lot of consequences as far as sea is concerned. Though the global warming is going to touch almost every wake of the life. But I have picked up few points as an oceanographer where sea is concerned. The likelihood of the accelerated rise in the sea level because of the thermal expansion of the seawater and melting of the ice at the polar regions. The change in monsoon pattern, because monsoon is also because of differential heating of land and ocean. The increase in the intensity and frequency of the storms are also one of the consequences of global warming, and it is also going to change the fisheries. We'll talk about the first point, the sea level changes. Because of its the lot of modeling has been done in recent years about the sea level changes, how sea level is going to change in the near future. You can see the different projections are there based on the modeling. And they say that they have used the tide gauge data also to model it. But friend, if greenhouse gases or because of the industrial development is the only cause for the climate change and sea level rise, sea level should not have changed in the past. It has changed in the past, which shows that there is other changes as well, the natural change. And unless we know the natural climatic variability, we cannot assess how much sea level will go in the near future and how it will affect particularly the low-lying areas along the coastal regions. Therefore, the study of the past sea level changes is must. How to get the idea about past sea level changes? Where are those records? How we can read those records? And whether we know or whether we can prepare a sea level curve which shows the changes in sea level in the past. Such records are available everywhere. I would like to start first the indication of sea level changes to the ancient man, which is available in form of the religious records. It is from the Gita, which says that they knew how sea level is going to submerge the Dwarka. It is available into the Quran, as well as in the Bible, the very famous story of the Noah's Ark. Hazrat Nuh was preparing an ark, a boat in a desert area, and he was ridiculed by the fellow citizens. Look, he's making a boat where there's no water. Probably he was the wise man around that time who knew that sea level is going to rise. Now, as a geology student, we all know that sea level, I remember when I was in school in the beginning, fourth or fifth class, I was told that Samudra apni maryada nahi todta. And this is a general belief that sea never breaks its boundary. Even our Prime Minister, when he was welcoming Chinese Prime Minister into Chennai, he wrote a poem. And there also he mentioned that sea maintains its boundaries. Apni maryada nahi to hota. But as a student of science, we know that sea has changed its level many times. And its magnitude also differed from time to time. As a geology student, we know where the highest mountain of the world, the Himalaya, stands today. Once upon a time, it was sea. It is called the Tethys Sea. You can see the boundary. India is here. So this is the boundary. But this is too old a phenomenon. Lot of part of Surat and Baroch area, as well as a big part of Tamil Nadu, was also under the sea, what we call it Cretaceous transgression and regression of the sea. But if we are interested to know what is going to happen to the mankind in future, as well as what happened in the past, how sea level has played a role in developing the mankind on this planet, the time framework in which we will be interested is about, say, mainly the Holocene. And this is a sea level curve from many areas. You can see the workers, and you can see this is the present sea level. And many times, sometimes sea level has gone above the present sea level, and sometimes it has gone down as compared to the present sea level. I'm sure you will not be able to see it because of a small screen, but all this curves has been generated by mostly the foreigners for a different places. Here, what I'm going to talk about sea level is a relative sea level, which also includes a part of the tectonics. So therefore, what has been generated for different seas and oceans of the world cannot be applied in toto for our seas, Indian Ocean or Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea. We have to generate our own understanding of the sea level fluctuation in the past. And this is very much required because there is a growing need to delineate the natural and human-induced changes. Therefore, at NIO, we had a group which is making efforts are being made to reconstruct the natural climatic variability over which the man's influence can be evaluated. See, here I say that over which man's influence can be evaluated, the natural climatic variability, but this also going to be of your interest, mostly the students of the archaeology. But the next question is, how to generate or how to reconstruct the natural climatic variability? For that, we have to use the seas, we can say, to enhance the understanding of past sea level changes through the study of microfossils with the special reference to foraminifera and marine sediments of Indian Ocean and adjoining seas. Now, here comes a word, microfossils, and with a special reference to foraminifera. In fact, friends, this is a branch in which I devoted my about 45, 46 year of life. And they're very useful. But first I will tell you how the marine sediments are useful. And then I will tell you about how foraminifera or microfossils can help you to generate sea level changes. See, if this is the land and this is the sea. Now, in sea, the sediment comes from land through river and it comes through the wind blown. So the sediments come into the sea, plus the lot of microorganisms, including foraminifera, they live into the water column and bottom of the sea. And when they get deposited, they get deposited at the bottom of the sea layer by layer, year by year. So they serve as the pages of Earth's history. You can take your ship, you can collect a core, see these layers. They will tell you what was the paleo environment when this animal used to live into the ocean. And that's also telling about the past climate and past sea level changes. Now, what are these microfossils and how they are going to tell about the past environment? The name of the, see, all sorts of microfossils or fossils are useful. I picked up only one group, which is called foraminifera. See, these are organisms which are exclusively marine organisms. Remember this word. They are exclusively marine organisms. They are less than a millimeter in size. They are extremely sensitive to the climate changes. There are two types of organism, one which live in the water column and thus indicate the environment of the top layer. They also live at the bottom called benthic or benthonic foraminifera. After their death, both get deposited at the bottom of the sea. Now, because of its sensitivity to the environment and a very wide diversity, more than about 10,000, 40,000 species has been reported, out of which 10,000 is almost from the recent sediment. We also have reported the distribution, the taxonomy of this group in form of about 15 PhDs in my lab, and about more than 2,000 species have been reported of this foraminifera. Now, because of its application, the foraminifera have been applied into variety of applications, starting from paleoceanography, sediment transport, which is an engineering application, petroleum, this is a age-old exploration, monsoon variation. With the help of this, you can get an idea how monsoon has varied in the past. Only one work I will tell you here, which I have not included further insights. We found the two great floods through the study of a core of Karwar, the work on which I got my first award, that monsoon precipitation was very high, around 4,500 years, which is almost equivalent to the two great floods reported in Rangpur excavation, as well as many of the other archaeological reports about the two great floods. We also got indication of that into the marine sediments. It is applicable to fisheries, how it varied in the past and how it is going to vary in the future. It also talk about paleoceanography. Today I will touch a part of it at Dhalavira. Now we will be going to talk about sea level changes and marine archaeology. And more recent and very, very useful application also in modern environment, it is in the pollution monitoring. So let us talk about two things, sea level changes and marine archaeology further. So foraminifera and sea level changes. So the idea is, first I would like to tell you in a very simple term, how to get the idea when sea level was higher than today and when sea level was lower than today. Because to know that one, it's very important to talk about marine archaeology as well as the modern changes in the modern climatic changes. See, when sea level was higher than today, you can see the notch here, the point here. See, this is a notch when sea erodes at certain places, if it is a rocky coast, and it leaves its signature of erosion. Now you can see the signature is here, but there is no sea. Sea is somewhere here, lower than this. It means this was done when sea level was high. Similarly, in South Goa, you can see a sea cave. Okay, and if those of you who have visited Dona Paula and visited the Sea Table restaurant, they might have seen it because now the restaurant has put up a bar here. This is a sea cave, which is also indicating a higher sea stain. Now, whatever has been eroded, this sediment from here has been deposited somewhere. Now, these deposits are known as beaches, where you go and enjoy in Goa, but they are also the place of deposit what has been eroded. Now, if you see the Chikalim Goa, if you come from airport to NIO in Goa, you can see these layers, some of which are already destroyed in the widening of the road. Now, there is no sea here, but you can see a layer which is full of foraminifera. This indicates that sea level was higher than today, and it is about 6,000 year old. Okay, so this there are many indications. I picked up the simplest one. And if you have any question regarding it, you can ask me very frankly. And one more thing I would like to mention here, that when you are asking question, I can tell you no question is a bad question. Only answer can be good or bad. Okay, so without any hesitation, you can ask that question. Now, after this, can see the sea level was lower than today. See, this is the Indian coast. About 60 to 90 meter water depth, if you see, you get a coral indicator species and a pinnacle into the ecogram. Now these species are indicating a very shallow water environment, and if you date them, it says about 8 to 10,000 years back. how it is possible. It is possible only when sea level was lower and they are at the, it was a shallow water environment when they were deposited. This is from PhD of Dr. Praveen Hangri, who is teaching or who is head of Department of Geology at Xavier, Bombay University. A similar type of species, we got it along the Myanmar coast. So you can see same type of species and same type of the pinnacle. Now, this is from Dr. Rajni Panchang's PhD. Now, she is at Pune University Ministry, Department of Environment. She's teaching there. So it is from their PhD. In a simple way, how this information, the shallow water indicator species at a deeper water, how they can indicate about sea level changes can be seen here. See, this species probably because it, I cannot use it, the slideshow, otherwise this is with the animation. See, when sea level was here, the shallow water indicator species used to live here. And when sea level started going up, they tried to migrate. And as sea level keep increasing, you can see that the reduction in the color intensity indicating the reduction in salinity also. So a time comes when this species coral indicator could not survive and they became extinct. So if you if you know the sea level, it was 100 meter lower here, and you can date radiocarbon date of this species. So date versus depth, if you plot, you will get an idea about sea level changes in the past. And that's what we compile first for the west coast of India. The Holocene sea level curve and marine archaeology, you can see this is the curve. It was published by Dr. Hashmi and me, published first time in 1995. Later we published it, modified in 2002, then 2012. See, the history of sea level curve, our study of sea level curve is still in infancy in our country. It was started by Dr. R.R. Nair of NIO long back. And afterward, Rajguru and Kale of your college published the first curve based on the four samples. After that, a lot of data has come and we compiled and we generated this curve. Now probably this curve also needs some more modification. I think probably next year we'll publish the updating of this curve. And even title of this curve, we put it in geology, an updated curve. Now you can see the sea level was about 100 meter lower than 15,000 years back. It started rising up. It was stable for some time here, okay, about 10 to 12,000, then very sharply and around 9,000, between 10,000, it was about 30 to 40 meter lower than, and around 6,000 year, it was higher than today. Around 3,500, it was lower than today. Around 2,000, it was higher than today. We got another signature here around 1,000, which we still we need to reconfirm it, and that's why we have not modified yet. Probably next time I will modify this portion also. Now, so this is a curve. Now this curve is also very helpful about marine archaeology. What is marine archaeology? You all know archaeology. I remember whenever I give a lecture, being a geologist and paleontologist, when I talk about archaeology in that gathering, they ask me, what is the use of studying the past? Let us concentrate on the future only. I always tell them, you know, along with the knowing the past, it, along with worrying about the future, it is also equally good to know about our past cultural heritage, because the one who is proud of his or her cultural heritage always work hard to maintain the high level of civilization and tries to enhance the living standard of the fellow citizen. Problem is, we Indians have a very poor sense of history. If you go to Europe or any other country, they are earning a lot of money through their archaeological findings. Okay, this is Angkor Wat in Cambodia. See, this is built by the Indian king Suryavarman. This is the biggest temple on our planet. The bulb and the Leibniz Baalbek temple also was built by Indians. But how many of Indians knew about the Rani Chivab or the steps of the Queen in Gujarat, which was built about 1050 AD? Unless it, when it came on the 100-year note. See, we have the oldest dockyard of the world. We have the oldest evidence of tsunami protection wall that Japan is making now. So we actually, there is a lot of scope. Not only this marine archaeology will help to enhance our cultural understanding, the role of sea in that also, but also have a scope to earn a lot of foreign currency by enhancing about the tourism. Whenever mostly tourists come to India, what we show them? Taj Mahal, Qutub Minar, Agra Ka Qila, that's all. And these things are not more than 400-500 years old. Whereas we have 4,000-5,000 year old well-protected places, but we are not projecting them properly. So it is duty of you people to take the marine archaeology to the masses, to the government, to the planners of the country. See, everybody talk about, know about Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, but Krishinde will must have talked to you about Rakhigadi. What a wonderful and important finding and the biggest Harappan site within our territory. How many foreign tourists are going there? Because we are still not selling them properly. So there is a need to sell. However, when it comes to where archaeological monuments have been governed by the sea, that comes under the jurisdiction of marine archaeology. And in India, marine archaeology started by Dr. S. R. Rao in 1981. He retired from Archaeological Survey of India and came and started the marine archaeology unit. This is another example. After retirement, people don't become useless. They need not sit at home. Dr. Asara started an entirely new branch of marine archaeology at NIO after the retirement. Of course, he started his work at Pumphar, but later he shifted his efforts to Dwarka, and which became a world famous discovery. I will touch a part of it. He became interested in marine archaeology because of his excavation at Lothal. So history of marine archaeology, in fact, started with the discovery of Lothal. Let us see. I need not go much in detail to this gathering where most of you are archaeologists. But still to refresh, the Lothal, meaning like Mohenjo-daro and Harappa in the Sindhi language means mound of dead. Similarly, is the Lothal is a mound of dead. It's about 12 kilometers away from the sea, few meters above the present sea level, and this was excavated by Dr. S. R. Rao in 1954. It became a very famous discovery because a full-fledged city came into existence, which is considered to be a contemporary to the Harappan civilization. But the, along with the Awaf, along with the drainage system, roads, cemetery, Awaf, Acropolis, this place became more well known about its a very famous tank-like body. And it became a controversial. In science or even in archaeology, nothing goes without controversy. Now, this is a place at Lothal. Now, Dr. Shinde is going to build a big museum of maritime history. And this is a very apt selection of a site because this is one of the very oldest discovery, about 4,500 years old. So let us come back to it. When it was discovered in 1954, it became a controversial problem. Dr. Asara, Leshnik, Fair Service, they are of opinion that this was the dockyard. And according to them, this dockyard was the world's oldest dockyard ever found. Okay, but the other group, and this is a picture depiction of how this was a dockyard connected through high tide to the sea, and spillover was going back. And these are the wharf houses, and this was the city. Now, Dr. Sankalia and Martin Wheeler Shah and many other archaeologists, they were of the opinion, no, this is not a dockyard, but it is a fresh water irrigation tank. And how they were arguing, I'm just telling in a very simplest way, though it is very lively, and it was a very interesting controversy. Two stones were found, which was having a hole like this. There were many arguments. I picked up the simplest argument, how they were discussing. See, one group was saying this stone was used as an anchor stone, which was found here. And since we found the anchor, the boat must be coming, and this was the dockyard. The other group is using the same stone. They're telling it's a counterweight to lift the water for the irrigation purposes. And for quite a long time, over 30, 40 years, this discovery was on. I visited the site in, I think, in 84 and came to know about this controversy. I was at PRL and they took me to the site. And then I found that why this controversy is on for such a long time. It need not be. This was on because archaeologists mostly were discussing with the archaeologists. Had they gone for an interdisciplinary approach and discussed with any paleontologist, geologist, probably this would not have continued for decades. See, what I have done, I have collected some samples from this bottom of this dockyard that was being excavated at the time, clean up. And if I ask you to solve this controversy, it is very easy. The sediments here I brought to my lab, and I found the well-preserved foraminiferal population. And today, if I compare it, it's very similar to the near shore or estuarine type of population. Now, I told you in the beginning that foraminifera are exclusively marine organisms. You can't find them into the rivers. At the most, you can see found in estuary where it is a brackish water. So since we found the exclusive marine organisms, it cannot be a freshwater irrigation tank. It must be filled with the seawater, and therefore it tilted the argument in favor of the dockyard. So this is settled, this controversy, that this was a dockyard and not an irrigation tank. But few questions remain to be answered still. If this was the dockyard, have you seen any dockyard on land away from the sea and few meters above the present sea level? How it is possible? That shows probably sea level was higher than today. That time this was connected to the sea and it was doing a roaring business. But when sea level started going down, this got cut off from the sea, became out of use, and it became an abandoned city later. So whether sea level was higher than today, around 4,500 years back, let us see what was the position of sea level. I presented this curve before to you. You can see 4,500 years sea level was higher than today. So this was the proof that yes, Lothal was a dockyard, and we must be very proud of it because this is so far as claimed by the archaeologist, particularly by Dr. S.R. Rao, that world's oldest dockyard ever discovered and which is in our territory. So this is the beginning of marine archaeology through Lothal. The next important site which became very important is the Dwarkadhish temple. Many of you must have seen these temples, but I am not sure how many of you have seen just where the police chowki is there, just an excavated just part. You can see the houses just above it is still. Now you can see a remnant of a temple. This was also discovered and excavated by Dr. S.R. Rao. Next time when you go, you can see it. He got an idea from here. That present sea level, the temple is here. Below that, there are a number of temples. And then he remembered Mahabharata, where it was mentioned that city of Dwarka was built by reclaiming the land from the sea by Lord Krishna, and which was later submerged into the sea. So he said, let us search into the sea whether we have any evidence of a submerged Dwarka. So, and he chose Anayo for that, because Anayo, below one roof, you have all sort of experts for the physics, chemistry, biology, geology, instrumentation, survey, whatnot. And this has given a big boost to our American aerial unit of NIO. See, these are the underwater work. NIO has done it quite a long work for more than decades. Now they found a, you can see the stone was remnant of an ancient city, which is now submerged about 6 to 8 meter water depth. Okay. You can see here, and this is now this was our flagship program of NIO, and it got a lot of publicity and given a visibility to NIO as well. Now the question, when they dated some of it, Dr. S. R. Rao, and he postulated the date 3,500 years before present, 1,500 years BC. Now if Dwarka is submerged, let us see how it can fit well into the sea level understanding. Same curve. It's like the magic lamp. It will keep coming. See here, 3,500 back, this is the time of Dwarka. Sea level was lower when the city was built. And you can see the sea level was going down. So you can reclaim the land from the sea only when sea level is going down. The city was built here. And when again the sea level has gone up, this became a submerged city. Okay? So this is another proof that yes, 3,500 years back, city was built, which is now under the sea. Now, when we talk about Dwarka, recently a report came. I'm just putting it for your information, and it's not my work, and I don't know much about it. But it is just Sonali excavation. See, Harappans were not using the weapons. It's mostly agricultural society. But Sonali, which is about 1,800 years before BC, slightly before the Dwarka time, you can see it became from agrarian society to the warrior society. You got a chariot, you got the sword. Okay, and Dwarka happened about roughly 300 years afterwards. So this change, this shows that this is the time when the urban civilization was built, kingdoms were developed, they developed inter-rivalry, capturing the other area, fighting the big wars, and therefore Mahabharata time and the Dwarka also may fit well into the story. Someone of you can develop a better story, how it is started, all from, you can say, from Rakhigali or Mohenjo-daro and Harappa coming to Dwarka. Okay. Now, after the Dwarka, there was another very famous discovery. This was a chance discovery by the National Institute of Ocean Technology in Chennai. They were doing this oceanographic survey in Gulf of Khambat of Surat. And they found a remnant of an ancient city. And it was a very sensational discovery because they dated it to about 7,500 years BC, means roughly 9.5 thousand years before present, approximately. And it was then the minister, as well as the secretary, Department of Ocean Development, they called a press conference. And India Today magazine brought out a special issue in 2000, the world's oldest city. Okay. but in science, what they say that nothing goes without controversy. The Outlook magazine brought out another issue just soon after that, and I say it is all hoax. And why? Because then the minister was put to the question, how you can have a city at 30 to 40 meter water depth? See, here the water depth was 30 to 40 meter. And time was 9,500 years. So when they were asked, can you explain, they say maybe perhaps because of the earthquake, because they knew the earthquake. The answer was not very convincing. So they say, no, it doesn't look like. But that time nobody took pain to discuss it in terms of the sea level changes. And then after that, I was presenting my sea level work to the Research Council of National Institute of Oceanography. The Secretary Department of Ocean Development was our chairman. He says, why can't you discuss the Neolithic settlement at Surat? And now see here. You see 9,500 years before present. See here. What was the depth that time? Between 30 to 40 meter water depth. This is what we got off Surat. We got this year old civilization at 30 to 40 meter water depth. You see here, today sea level is here. But 9,500 years back, sea level was here. And it was almost rising very slowly. Okay, and this curve was published first time in 95. And this India Today, that discovery came in 2002. So nobody can say the curve was prepared to suit them. So it was possible to have any civilization at this time, at this water depth, at this time, which was the sea and water land interaction, and now which is 30 to 40 meter water depth. So this also explained another finding. And now you can claim, as the India Today was telling, the world's oldest city, we must be very proud, that found within our territory. The next important thing is what Dr. Shinde told in his beginning of this, or introducing me, about Dhaulavira. See, Dhaulavira in Gujarat, first time it was noticed by Dr. Jagatpati Joshi. Later it was excavated by Dr. Bisht, who got the Padam Shri for his excavation, and the report came in 2015. Okay, but the excavation was between 90 to 2005. This place, entire city came into the existence, and this place became world famous for its excellent water conservation system. Very excellently they have done a water conservation system. But we believe that probably this was a port town. This was about 5,000 to 6,000 years. And if you see that, it is possible to have a city because city was, the sea level was a little higher than today. So sea was more closer to the Dhaulavira than it is today. And it was a port town. And there is a landing point near to it. It's at Saran. I'm just missing the name from Geological Survey of India. I think Rawatji, who was also a party to this excavation along with the Bishop. So this was a port town, but there is another important thing. Along with this excellent water conservation system, the outer wall about 6 to 7 meters thick was this. This is a citadel, middle town, lower town. Now the citadel, if you see, it has been protected from all the sides by 18 meter thick wall. Why this 18 meter thick wall has been built? I remember I asked this question to Dr. Bisht when he gave a lecture on Dhaulavira at Anayo. He said, must be for the protection. But he has not explained it further. But it raised further questions. If it is protection against whom? Protection against flood or natural calamity like flood. This is a water-starved region. Okay, that's why they built such a huge reservoirs, which became world famous. Protection against animal. Protection against animal, you have to build an 18-meter thick wall, even thicker than China wall. The thickest wall any port which is having India is about Kumbhalgarh, 15 feet. then this much thick wall, then against the protection against enemy, what was the ammunition of your enemy around 6,000 year back, 5,000 year back? Must be bows, arrows, stones and all. For that you need not build 15 meter, 18 meter thick wall. We proposed that this wall, we published this paper in Current Science, and we prepared another paper also as well, that this is the first ever evidence that it is against the tsunami, because Dholavira is along the Makran coast, and Makran coast is prone, tsunami prone area. And way back in, I think 2000, we published a paper for Subodh Chaturvedi's thesis that this region witnessed around a big tsunami around 8,000 year back. So when it comes to 6,000, means resident of this area knew that this is tsunami prone area, but it was very strategic for business point of view. Still they have to build a society, but they have built this wall to protect the most important installation of castle by 18 meter thick wall. But we have done further survey. Is there any evidence of tsunami in this area? So what we did in a middle town area, we did the GPR survey. Now this GPR survey, this is a very good instrument, and those who are attending today, I will tell them to start using this instrument more extensively. Actually, this need to be done more even in the Lothal for unexplored part, because exploration or digging is a more expensive thing. First, you can do a GPR survey to get an idea what is buried below the sediment. Okay? And then wherever you find some evidence, you can excavate the area. You are going to discover many new findings. So please remember that this is for your future. Start using GPR for more areas. Now we used it in a middle town area, and what we found here is a 2.5 to 3 meter thick sediment, which have no layering. Normally, if you go to the beach or riverside and you cut a section, you will get the layered sediment, because they are getting year by year the sediment deposited. But if you take a one truckload of sediment and dump it, they will not have any layer. So is this one. Now, so we found that this is one time deposit, which not having level, such a thick one, from where it came. Either it came from the river or it came from the seaside. See, if came from the river, so what we did a trench. This is Dr. Lawson, who has done the GPR survey, and this is Rupal Dubey. She got Young Scientist Award for this work, and she collected the samples from this layer. In this layer, we got a foraminifera. So this has proved that the sediment came from seaside in form of a big tsunami, and this tsunami has destroyed at least lower and middle town. I will talk more about this when I will talk about, after a few days, me and Dr. Shinde is going to discuss this in detail. So this is what I have talked so far on the West Coast. Dr. Sable, today I'm not going to discuss Gopikapatnam, which you mentioned, that the site where your students going for other training, because their work is still incomplete. But I can tell you one thing, that Gopikapatnam is an excellent example that an ancient port exists in this area about 1,000 years back. But now I will shift to the east coast of India. The east coast of India also, very famous place is Mahabalipuram. Our Prime Minister a few years back has visited this place. Many of you also might have seen this place. Now, the last 2004-2005 tsunami has done a wonderful job in this area. See, towards north of this ancient temple, which is considered to be about 1,000 year old by Chola kings. North of it, the tsunami erode some sediments. This is the road you can see here. This part of the rock was exposed. So they started excavating in this area. Then you can see that the entire temple complex appeared, which was buried into the sediment and which are looking like a beach of today. So this gave us the idea that let us explore in this area more. What we did a little GPR survey towards south of the temple. And to our surprise, if you go to Mahabalipuram and go in this area, what I am showing you, evening time there is a big market and people are selling that all souvenirs. But to our surprise, the GPR survey indicated that southern of this temple also have buried structures like we have seen into the northern part, which was Selva Kuppam area. This was Selva Kuppam. Now I'm talking about, so this is another big discovery waiting. Some of you can take up this work in the near future and you're going to be a more famous person. But not only on the land we have done it, we have done a survey in offshore area. Okay, there is no mention of submergence of Mahabalipuram in any Indian literature. Okay, but when we did a little survey in off Mahabalipuram area, to our surprise, what we found, you can see, this is underwater of Mahabalipuram. You can see the stone structure, which is also at 6 to 8 meter water depth. You remember what I showed you in off Dwarka? See here. This indicate that the Mahabalipuram was a temple town. It was having a huge complex, okay, part of which is now buried into the beach, and part of it of which is also under the sea. I call it as a Dwarka of South. And this is also need to be surveyed in more detail. And this is also a big discovery actually in meeting. Long 2 or 3 years back when I was in the job, I had a press conference which was very widely covered about this Mahabalipuram. You can see just that this is structures. So part of, and present town, if you see the Mahabalipuram, it is made up of charnokite, geological rock, and this is, which is the locally available rock, and that's why it is a, this rock is erosion prone. So entire temple, you can see the pitted one. But here the offshore work, remnants, this is laterites. Very surprising, laterite is not here. It means it has to be brought from somewhere and turn out to be expensive, but this ancient town was built of laterite and not the charnokite. Okay, so this is another thing which need a further exploration. Now I'm coming to another very controversial and probably the last part of my lecture today about the Ram Setu. Many of you have gone to the Ram Setu, and Ram Setu became very famous in last, you can say, the decade. Still, almost every month some new news comes. I understand Government of India has given a big project now to NIO to explore further. But long back when this controversy started, it was believed that, for example, Ram has built a bridge to go to Sri Lanka during the Ramayana time. And that time I used to get a lot of phone calls from the journalists about my opinion about Ram Setu, because Government of India gave an undertaking telling that Ram was an imaginary talk and there's nothing like a Ram Setu. Okay, so I used to ask them, you give me the date, when it, what is the time of Ramayana, I will tell you whether it is possible for me to comment. And since nobody was telling me exactly the date of Ramayana time, so I was also not answering. But later, a group of scientists in Delhi, people who are not exactly, you can, scientists, but they are doing a job better than any scientist can do. They have accumulated the evidences of star position from Ramayana with a painstaking work. And those positions, they have fed into planetarium software and calculated the time of Ramayana, when this star combinations was occurring, because star combinations occur and they repeat only after a long time. According to that, the time comes around 5100 year BC. Now it's okay. It means more than 7000 year before present. That was the time given by this. If this timing is correct, what I can tell you, see here, the sea level curve. Around 7000 years, sea level was about 2 to 3 meters lower than today. And if you see the sea between India and Sri Lanka of Ram Setu area, it is about 10 feet deep, mostly. So if you lower it by 2 to 3 meters, that water, India and Sri Lanka almost get connected, okay, except few small shallow water patches which can be bridged by putting up stones or trees and whatnot. And a causeway can be built 7,500 years back, which connects India and Sri Lanka. Okay, so what we can say, actually big confusion came because of this word Ram Setu or Adam's Bridge. When you say bridge or Setu, what comes to our mind immediately is like a flyover. As probably Rama has built a bridge, no. That is, in Sanskrit, we call it Setu Bandh Rameshwam. It is a bandh, it is a causeway. Means when, so, even in the river, when you see, when water is less, people put the stones and they make a causeway. Here also, Ram Setu was a causeway. So I can say that the Ram Setu was not, or Ram was not an imaginary thing. We have a scientific evidence to prove that 7,100 back, it was possible to collect India, Sri Lanka by putting up this Ram Setu. With this, and if you see, this is actually the curve which we basically made for Arabian Sea recently. In 2019, we published another curve, me and Lawson, for the Bay of Bengal. And you can see around the same time, sea level was slightly lower than today, around 7,000 years before present. So whether you take Arabian Sea side or Bay of Bengal side, sea level was lower at this given time, and therefore it is possible to have a Ram Setu. So we can see actually that sea level was not a constant phenomenon. It was not a static phenomenon. It was combination, the relative sea level is a combination of both, little bit new tectonics is involved, but mostly it is the sea level which fluctuated. When it was higher than today, it has created places like Dholavira and Lothal, which became out of use because sea level has gone down. Then we have a places like Dwarika or Mahabalipuram or Ram Setu, which was built when sea level was lower, and they became under the water when sea level has gone up. It means sea level has always played a very important role in shaping the destiny of coastal towns. It is likely to do it in the near future also. If no preventive measures taken and sea level is allowed to grow uncontrolled, as a lot of people are suspecting, this is a cutting from Navin Times Panjim, the Vinci underwater Panjim next. The accelerated rise in sea level may be possible. A lot of the cities which are now in low-lying areas, flourishing cities, will become the property of the marine archaeologists of the future, maybe after a few hundred years. So let us take a pledge that control that, because of our doing, because of adding carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases, let us not increase the changes in sea level, which is otherwise normal and takes a longer time. So let us protect our seas from pollution, all sort of pollution. The sea pollution is water pollution, which affects the fisheries, which indirect affect the human, because fish provide a lot of protein to the mankind, and also it has affected the past. So thank you very much. Let us not create a property for future archaeologists. This is a small step to unravel the past in order to illuminate the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. That was indeed a very insightful and a wonderful lecture. And so now we are open to discussion. If you have any query, you can either type it in the chat box or you can directly ask to Nigam sir, whichever suits you. Let me just check the chat box once. No, we don't have, till now we don't have a query. So anybody has any query, any question?
Hi, I have raised my hand, but it looks like it doesn't show that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Niranjan, sir. Yes, please go ahead.
Can I ask?
Yes, sir. Of course. Go ahead.
Yeah, sir. It was nice listening to you. I almost two or three points. I almost felt like reading an Amitav Ghosh novel. In fact, I have two, three questions, sir. One is the
sir. Just wait a minute. Let me put the headphone so I can hear you more clearly. Just. One second, wait. Yes, sir, you can ask.
Yeah, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, sure, very well.
Yeah, the first question that I wanted to ask, the graph you showed us is between the time and the level of C, right?
Yes.
But as I see it, the zero, the present line doesn't start at the point of zero. That x axis doesn't start at zero of y. Why?
I will tell you, it is very, very difficult to get the idea of past sea level of the from the marine sediment because the resolution is very poor in the marine sediment. Therefore, in fact, if you remember the sea level curve by Rajguru Kale, it was based on only four dates. Mm-hmm. Okay. After that, whatever dates come, we have put it. And that portion, 1,000, very, very little dates are available. So we are not very sure. And oceanography side, it is very difficult to give a very high resolution data. But I will tell you, the results which is coming from Gopikapatnam. See, so far we geologists propose or claim we are helping archaeologists, but this time the help is actually coming from archaeologists to geologists, because Gopikapatnam is indicating the sea level was lower about 1,000 year back. And when I see Dr. Nilay Khare's thesis, there was a small trough at around 1,000 which we have not interpreted. So you are correct. We have very little data for 1,000. We need to reinterpret and regenerate the data. That is a future work for the future geologist.
Okay. Another question, can I ask?
Sure.
Yes, please.
If we extend this study of yours about Sundarbans in Bay of Bengal, can we say that the Sundarbans were a part of land only? And only after the sea level change that it became a part of sort of say delta or something like that.
See, sir. Yes, sir. Good question, sir. See, Sundarban area is a very complicated oceanographic history. Sundarban means progradation of the land in the deltaic region. So if it is prograded, sea will be pushed behind. So you will get an idea as sea level is going down. In fact, sea level also may be going up, but because of land progression, you may feel sea level is going down. So Sundarban is a complex history of rise in sea level. See, sea level is not possible to go lower at Sundarban and not at say Odisha or in Chennai. It has to be uniform for Bay of Bengal. I have seen a parallel between the Myanmar coast, which is Rajni Panchang's thesis, and in Rana's thesis, the four thesis we have done on the east coast of India. It is good. But Sundarban is having a very complicated history. I think Bengal, that Manju Banerjee's group, they have published some work on the sea level changes from Sundarban area. But we cannot tell very sure unless a very detailed geological work has been done. It has been done by mostly the biology people. And NIO is also planning to have a project on Sundarban for quite a long time.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. And I also thank the organizers for this wonderful lecture they have organized. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else have any question? Okay. So we have a question in the chat box from Sushmetha Shivakumar. He's telling, I am a graduate in geography. Now I'm interested into geoarchaeology. So I'm searching for case studies in India and Tamil Nadu. Okay, it's not a question, it's just a statement.
Good. At least I'm very happy that someone is looking a place in Tamil Nadu. If you remember in my lecture, I was dropping the hint for youngsters what they can take up as their research area. Tamil Nadu, just now I told you, the Mahabalipuram area, onshore as well as offshore, means near shore as well as on onshore, offshore area, both are equally important. Tamil, Pumphar is another area. Pumphar, of course, been attempted by some of the South Indian University, but Mahabalipuram is still a lot of work can be done. We have done GPR survey south of Mahabalipuram. You can take up that work once again. And wherever you get a buried structure, it's not very difficult. Take a JCB machine, go and it's excavated immediately. If you get a buried structure, can you think how famous you will be within no time? And archaeologically, that will be a big contribution to this country. Okay. Similarly, with the offshore areas, why not somebody try to put the story in line like the one it has been put in Dwarka? Dwarka is still, we think that after working two decades, still we feel there is more to tell in the story. In Tamil Nadu, it will be very good if you take up, you or any other student, the GPR work. And GPR is not a very difficult or complicated. See, record anybody can generate, I will tell you. That is a problem. At least dozen of universities have a GPR. Okay, some people tried the GPR. I'm not naming the university in Dholavira area. But still they have not told any story about it. Our GPR studies indicated that the occurrence of tsunami. See, I told you about 18 meter thick wall which has been built to protect themselves from the tsunami. But because of GPR work, we are able to tell tsunami did hit that area even after the construction. And it has crossed over the 7 meter wall, destroyed the lower and middle town. I will tell more when I will join the work with Dr. Shinde. I think after some time, it was due last Sunday, but we could not do it. So Dholavira is another site which is waiting. See, if middle town is destroyed, what happened to the tsunami has crossed this 18 meter thick wall or not? Lot of questions. Then you can do a work in Lothal as well. See, most of the archaeological site, only little part has been excavated because that is a very expensive job. You dig it and you don't know what you will get it down. But if you do the GPR survey in advance, you can get an idea where are the chances of getting buried structures. So there's a, and wherever you have a controversy, whether it was a freshwater influence or whether it was a marine influence, you can use this microfossils. Okay, very easily. So what we require, archaeology cannot remain as a branch confined to only historians and archaeologists. There is a role for all of us, those who are doing isotope studies, those who are doing GPR, geophysical studies, those who are paleontologists, geologists. So the lady who asked the question, there is a lot of scope. And Deccan College is giving a training in marine archaeology. Okay, you can attend that training and I can assure you very soon there will be vacancies in at least National Institute of Oceanography because right now there are not many geology people there. Those who are there mostly they are historians and technical officers. They're going to retire there and I has to recruit more archaeologists. I asked Professor Shinde when we started this work, all state archaeology departments of the coastal states should be contacted to appoint the people, the archaeology people with the training in marine archaeology. See, we did some survey in Kollam area in Kerala. And there also we are finding it, the stone anchors and the evidences of the lower sea level and an ancient port. There are ports which are abundant on land, like in Goa, the Chandor port, when sea level was higher. Another question which I keep asking to the people, most of the archaeological or marine archaeological things, why it is in Gujarat only? What about South India? Nobody was living. See, there is a human tendency. If you get one finding somewhere, then everybody will go and jump to that field and start looking at adding on knowledge to that area. So there is a more work required in South India, because if Ram Setu, I am telling it is true. Rama has not taken his army from Ayodhya. He built up the army in South India. Okay, and reached up to. So it means people were living. If people were living, what are those habitations? Where are those habitations? You need to search. There's a lot of work for archaeologists to do in our country. Very little has been done so far. And I'm good that present government is taking a note of it. Shinde Saab is here. He's building a good museum at Lothal. And I understand now he got a very good project for Rakhi Gali. So good days for archaeologists.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is actually associated to Ram Setu. It's from Shantanu Vaidya. Yeah. He's telling sea level had gone down during 1900 BC to 1300, 1400 BC. Can that be more helpful for Ram Setu?
See, whenever sea level is lower, okay, whenever, if you go to, see, I presented you about Surat work about India Today, which I showed you, which is about 9.5 thousand year back. Sea level was 30 to 40 meter before present. Probably that time, even no efforts were required to go to Sri Lanka. It was connected by land itself, without any efforts. Okay, when Ram came, there was a little effort was required to prepare a bund by filling up the shallow water areas between India and Sri Lanka. It was possible because sea level was lower. It was very, very shallow water. Many places it must be exposed also. So if you go to sea level changes, whenever sea level how much, you can connect India and Sri Lanka. Because Ram Setu got additional importance and additional discussion because of its religious relevance, one. And second thing, because of the efforts to break it, to so that ship which is going from west coast to east coast or vice versa, they cannot cross because they still water is very shallow. So they have to take the full round of Sri Lanka to go to. See, if you want to go from Kerala to Chennai, you have to take a full round of Sri Lanka. So that was an economic affair. So these are all the things made the Ram Setu, and particularly at the time of Rama, is more important and discussed.
So the next question is from Iman Ganguly. She's asking, sir, what's the recent updates from world's oldest city or marine archaeology in the Gulf of Khambat?
Nothing.
Okay.
Because what happened, when this report came, it became very big sensation. See, problem is land, anyone can go to any time. If you want to work on Lothal, even you can go tomorrow. At the most, you have to take a permission from Archaeological Survey of India, that's all. But in ocean is a very expensive science and a very indirect science. Means you have to take a ship to go to this place. And ship is about 2.5 lakh per day is the ship charges itself. Okay. Particularly if you go to dive in these areas, first thing, you cannot drive to such a depth. even if you go there, visibility became very poor. I remember in Dwarka region, the secretary to government of India telephoned, they wanted to put a tube to develop as a tourist interest place. They said, sir, please don't do it. Because people have an impression that you go to Dwarka, go to 6 meter water depth by any means, by tube or something, and you will walk into the bedroom of Krishna. You will see a palace there under the water. When on the land, like if you see any Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, Dholavira, everywhere, what you get mostly the foundation. That's what you get into the Dwarka also. When on land, within no time, the upper structure is destroyed. You expect that 3,500 years something was in the sea and will remain intact. It will not. So that's why of Surat area, it's a good question. I wish, I'm an old timer now. So I wish those who put up this question will take up this work. But I can assure you, any of this topic which I touched, if you do it, you're putting your hand on gold mines.
We have another question from Sushmita again.
Yes.
Sir, how can we identify the destruction, how it happens and how it is destroyed? I'm not sure what destruction she is meaning.
Can you ask her to unmute the mic and ask?
Yeah, Sushmita, if you're there, please unmute yourself and you can directly ask the question to sir. Sushmita, are you there?
Okay.
Yes, you can ask. You can ask.
Hello, sir. Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Sir, if we the buried city is there, no, sir. How can we the city was destroyed? How can we identify that? Is there any instrument?
Okay. Yeah. See, if you want to see something buried and on land, I'm telling you, not in the sea, because in sea also, like shipwrecks, for example, this is another branch of archaeology, and some of my colleagues in NIO are working. They've done extensive work on shipwrecks, which I don't touch it. See, buried structure into the sea, you can see it with the seismic records, magnetometer, shallow seismic record, mud penetrator. There are instruments, geophysical instruments, which we lower from the boat and we see what is below the sediment. On land, GPR is the best instrument. The ground penetrating radar is very simple instrument. If you remember my slides, like a box, you go, you make a grid pattern. Okay, first, whichever site you want. And the record comes, which says that if something hard structure is there, you can get the idea. This we tested it, because even I was very surprised. This was a instrument which is extensively used by civil engineer. Okay, it is used by civil engineer to find out their nala, submarine, just submarine nalas or pipelines, cables for that. We started using them for marine archaeology. So only thing, these records are, you can say, in a very scientific form, so you can see. So you can use GPR record. I will tell you more details some other time. Are you come to NIO? Meet Dr. Lawson. He's the best expert in GPR.
Thank you so much, sir. There is no other questions, but there is a lot of appreciation post. Yes?
Somebody.
Good afternoon,
Sanskriti.
Sir.
Yes, Sanskriti, yeah. Please ask. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, good afternoon.
Sir, I remember reading your and your teammates' paper that was published in Current Science, December 2016. It was on tsunami, Dholavira and tsunami.
Yes.
Sir, there was this line, this particular one line, in which you mentioned that the inland portions of the coastline of Kutch have features that amplify the effects of tsunami waves when they are coupled with the high tide, thus become fatal. What are those features?
See, First thing, I don't remember what we wrote, but I will tell you what I remember now. See, first thing is Dholavira was a port town or not. Okay, because right now sea is very far. So it is put 5,000 to 6,000 years back, and that is without any controversy or offshore. 5,000 to 6,000 years back, sea level was higher than today. It means sea was much closer to the Dholavira. Okay. High tide thing many times reach like Lothal. Even if you raise the sea level, you can't reach to the Lothal. It means it was connected through high tide, like Garden Reach Workshop or Calcutta Diamond Harbor of today, where ships can reach only during the high tide. So in this area, but second question comes about the tsunami. First thing, whether it was a port town or not. Yes, it was a port town. Then about tsunami, this 15 meter, what you're telling current sounds paper, it says that 18 meter thick wall probably built to protect themselves for the tsunami. So if they know that this area is tsunami, for the first thing, whether the area was tsunami prone area or not. Yes, even now it is a tsunami prone area. Even 8,000 year back, we have a record. We published the paper in Geomarine Letters, 1995, you can see that paper. That tsunami occurred in Kutch area. So it means people living there, they knew that this is tsunami. Like Japanese know that it is tsunami prone area, and they built 11 meter thick wall now. Okay, here in ancient Indian, 5,000 year back, they knew how to protect themselves from tsunami. Okay, they built 18 meter thick wall. Okay, and they built 18 meters because it was a very expensive thing. So they built it for the most VIP areas. Outer wall, if you see, it is not 18 meter thick. And our studies through GPR, as well as the trenching and occurrence of foraminifera, that tsunami did hit that area despite this. And whether that, we feel that that may be one of the cause of decline of Dholavira. But this is another area. We did a very small area. What happened to lower town? What happened to the within the citadel? Take your GPR, and when you take a research project, go there. Lot of scope. We started it. We have not ended it.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Good. Can you hear my voice, sir?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. Please. Okay. And sir, it is a very interesting lecture from sea level changes and archaeology related. My question is, you discovered in 1995 paper the sea level curve.
Yeah.
At the using from the tool that is foraminifera, it is very interesting. And the 2002, that is your paper, also very good. The west coast of India, sir, the west flowing rivers, that is, for example, Bird River, Karli River, then the Kelsi River, they are flowing toward from east to west, and near to the coast, they are either flowing toward south or toward north. And the development from the sandbar, sand spit, etc. It is the newer tectonic features, or what it is the.
See, the problem is, first thing, they on west coast, most of the rivers are making estuaries. They are not making deltas, except Indus when you go to the. Whereas on the east coast, most of the rivers are making deltas because they travel a lot through the sediment area. Okay, and they take a lot of sediment and goes to the sea. West coast, the rivers are very, very short. They just very come short. Out and meet the sea. So there is not much scope. And what sandbar, other thing, actually, this is a phenomena which is related to the monsoon.
Okay.
Since you talk it, you must be aware. The sandbars are not a permanent feature. So the sea is pushing those sediments. Because I live very near to this place, the sea. So I see it at Miramar every year. there is a time when sandbar has been built up, and after monsoon it is over again. See, the boats can come inside. Okay, so this is a entirely different oceanographic phenomena, which is nothing to of at moment any significance in the marine archaeology field. Yeah, but it is good for those who are working on sea level changes to have a note of it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
If you have any supplementary question, you don't hesitate to ask. If you think that you have not got the answer, keep asking the question. Okay.
Okay. Can I interrupt for a minute, Raj?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, Kesava. Yeah. Yes, you can.
The sandbar that you were talking about on the in the mouths of some rivers.
Yeah.
That forms mainly not inside the estuary. At the mouths on the coast, the beach. Yes. That is mainly because of the longshore transport takes place on the beaches.
Yes.
So the growth is towards the direction of the longshore sediment transport. If the sediment transport is towards the south, the bar formation will be towards south. If it is towards north, it will be towards north. Okay.
Okay, Milind, I will tell you, Dr. Keshav Das. He's a very senior oceanographer. He was with us. Now he's at Cochin. And he, Keshav, how are you?
I am okay. Thanks a lot.
So, Dr. Keshav Das has explained, because he's a physical oceanographer. He knows the subject of sandbar better than me or anyone right now. Okay, thank you, Keshav, for explaining the question. Okay.
Anyone else have any question? Any query? Okay, there is any.
But
there
I mentioned something in the chat box. You didn't bother. I was telling when you were talking about sea level, no? You also give the students something on ice ages, some information on ice ages.
Yes, Dr. Keshav Das, this ice ages thing, actually, that is more of the Pleistocene time.
Yeah.
Okay. The last glacial maxima occur about 18,000 years before present. But most of the developments in the human, civilization-wise, I'm telling you, civilization, this is all happening during the late Holocene.
So, just for the sake of the students, you know, so they should also know about that.
See that, I will tell you, I was expecting somebody will ask that question. Why the sea level go up and down? Okay, in a very simple term, that whenever there is a formation of ice on the poles, lot of fresh water has been taken out from the sea and deposited in form of the ice, so sea level go down. Okay, whenever there is a warming, this ice start melting, thermal water expansion, that water come into the sea and sea level go up. So this is happening naturally. Many times it happened in the history of the earth. But what now we are talking about sea level, actually for archaeology, past sea level, it was nothing to do with any interference from the man. It was all mostly the natural phenomena. Okay, there are many reasons for that. But now, whatever we are talking about global warming now, it is we are trapping more outgoing energy. Okay, and this may accelerate this climate change and may harm us. So this is what I can add at the moment, what Keshav was telling me. Any more questions?
Thank you.
Welcome.
I don't see any more questions in the chat box. There is a lot of appreciation statements, sir. Everyone has thanked you for an excellent lecture and to present your research in such a lucid way. But I don't see any more questions other than that. So now I think I will invite our HOD again, Professor Sable, sir, to give the vote of thanks.
Before formal vote of thanks starts, I must thank you all for patiently listening to me. And the best vote of thanks will be if some of you will join the marine archaeology in the future. Thank you.
I think, sir, you will receive many emails right now, because I have already so many in my WhatsApp. Ki please share us his email. We are so interested to join this project and that project, and we want to write to him. So please expect some.
Most welcome. We are waiting for you.
Sir, before concluding
this lecture, so can you add some lines on the this course? Because of your efforts and Shinde sir's efforts only, this course we have started in the Deccan College. So most of the time students are asking, what is the scope for underwater archaeology? You have mentioned in one line, but can you elaborate just within 1-3 minutes?
Problem is, this is a very new branch, the marine archaeology. Credit goes to SRO to start it. We didn't have any trained marine archaeologist. Okay. People like me, actually, I am not an archaeologist in any way. I am basically a geologist, paleontologist, and because of Lothal work, I drifted and tried to interpret some of finding, which is actually done by archaeologists. I provided the explanation for that. But I felt a need that we need more trained marine archaeologists. I can see a very bright future. Only thing that those who are leader in oceanography now, because a lot of oceanography institutes now come up in the past, they should realize the importance of the cultural heritage. Okay, of late, particularly the present government is very keen to enhance our understanding of cultural heritage. Marine archaeology is a part of it. So when government emphasis is there, obviously the job prospects will increase. I will tell you in NIO the present setup. There are only 3 technical offices in marine archaeology. I have talked to you about, because we from different branches collaborated to it and enhanced its scope. Our geophysics people participated in it, our geochemistry people, surveyor, so many people. So if we get a trained archaeologist, marine archaeologist, NIO and other oceanography institution are the best place. So therefore this training was started, and I will tell you, this training attract. You remember, Sable Saab, when we wanted to start this course, we thought if we get 10 students, it will be sufficient.
Yes, yes.
We got 60 students.
Yeah.
After that, this actually, sometime I review, my micropaleontology lectures are not becoming that popular as this marine archaeology lectures are popular.
I have
been invited all over the country. Wherever I go and deliver, people, I tell about this course. They said they want to join this course. I said, look, sorry, you cannot join. Even my son wanted to join this course, who is now in the States. Because you are having a part-time job or Saturday, Sunday, only Pune people can join. You, Sable Saab, I gave this proposal before also. Again, yeah. I'm repeating this proposal.
Yeah.
If you can make this course online.
Yeah.
Okay. If Pune University is not giving you idea, you are a deemed university. You can start this course if possible. If Pune, if your rules are not permitting it, get hold of any other university in Pune who is prepared to do it, you become a collaborator. Okay, start an online course. I will tell you, you will get the students in hundreds and thousands.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, this is very, and Shinde Saab, I don't know where he is still around, or Joshi ji, please keep propagating the application of marine archaeology and its importance. Okay, and moreover, you should add the tourism part of it. See, no yes. branch of science will survive unless it is converted into some sort of money. Okay, people consider archaeology only, you have to spend money on them, you will not get anything in return. You know, this government is very keen. If I give you 100 rupees, how much you will return? That's why satellite people are getting maximum importance.
Yeah.
Now you say that, for example, I will tell you example of Dholavira. When we were doing the survey work there, a collector's family came from Gujarat and they were bewildered looking this side, that side. They don't know what it is. Then we explain and then they are very excited. See, Dholavira have a guest house. But if you go there, you don't get a guide. If you go to any rooms, unless somebody explains to you, it is not interesting. What can be done? All these places can be numbered. You put a route, put a recorded headphones. Like in USA, you go to any archaeology site, they do it. And then you put a headphone, deposit 100 rupees, have a round around Dholavira, come back, return your headphone. See, this type of thinking and this type of actually initiatives are required from the NGOs. Government alone cannot do everything. So someone, the local people can get together and do it and go on writing, all of you, go on writing a lot of popular lectures, popular articles, explaining the finding, importance of your finding. Okay, writing lectures, giving popular talks. So it is your duty, archaeologists, to make your branch important and link it with the tourism. So this marine archaeology course is a very good course. I will recommend everybody to join it. And I request the organizer to make it online course. Thank you.
Sir, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Now you can propose your vote of thanks.
Yeah. Madam?
Yes, sir. Please, sir. Go ahead.
See, friend, as you know, in number of lectures, I am using the name of Dr. Raju Nigam, sir. And how this course is start, and this is the unique course in Deccan College in collaboration with National Institute of Oceanography and this Department of EISA and Archaeology. We have started this activity in 2013-14, and immediately, because of the positive and very good cooperation from NIO side, because that time Dr. Raju Nigam sir was heading the earth sciences and this underwater archaeology section. And within short time, we get the green signal. I was there two times during the discussion of this course and syllabus and everything. So within short time, we get a very good response. And we immediately, within 2 months, I designed this syllabus. I sent to NIO expert, and the course was started in the next semester. So now, right from the 2014, so this course is, sir, very successfully we are running because of the collaboration. And I always, number of times I told you, so this is because of the help and guidance and all kind of the support of Dr. Raju Nigam sir and Shinde sir. And I was only coordinated. I designed syllabus and all kind of thing, but it was become possible because of the guidance and help from the NIO. And I always tell you ki the help sir is always the motor behind us to start this course and run this course. And today, even though every year sir is conducting very nice lectures, wherever, because of the pandemic situation, it was not becoming possible to take the student at Goa. But wherever we are going to Goa, sir is always, means what, it is a force continuously. So many scientists are required for the training and all kind of thing. So continuously he is taking follow up. So these student, marine archaeology students, should expose with all kind of knowledge like GPR training, DGPS, then this geophysical, all the instrument. We taking the student at Gopikapatnam port, and we are training. So sir is not only helping for the lecture, but he is a force behind the all the training and all kind of thing. And wherever we need any kind of help, sir is always coming and giving help. So every year he is delivering the lecture, very wonderful lecture in our class. So on the behalf of our Deccan College, Deemed University, on the behalf of this course and student and all staff, I thanks to sir for sharing your very valuable knowledge and your experience and very, very, very practical knowledge with our student. And thank you for your time and efforts which you have taken for this lecture. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And thank you, everyone. Sir. Thank you, everyone, for joining this lecture today after a long time. Thank you all. And wherever we are putting this departmental lecture series, wherever we announce any lecture, you are giving overwhelming response. Thank you for your response. Thank you all. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Yes, just continuing on Sabli sir's note before I end this call. Today we have a lot of people who have joined us outside the Deccan College circle, and each and every week we are getting new students and faculties from different institutes from across India. So if you want to stay updated with all the archaeology discussion group series lecture, please keep an eye on our Facebook page, Deccan College Facebook page. See, I have already shared the link in the chat box. Go to that link, keep an eye on our Facebook and Insta pages, and you will always be updated with all the upcoming lectures along with the links and everything, because we have made them open to all now. So thank you once again. Thank you, Nigam sir.
Thank you.
And thank all of you for your patient hearing. Bye-bye. See you next time.
Thank you. Bye.